So when this IMD is calculating or IMD is forecasting our Indian monsoon, it considers various factors. But we need to understand how these models evolved over a period of time and what was the earlier stage of this prediction levels and when we actually predicted first time for the Indian monsoon. Hi friends, today we'll discuss the prediction of Indian monsoon system. So why actually this is important? Because recently the Indian Meteorological Department in her April forecast, they have given that the 96% of the LPA, that means this year we are going to experience a normal monsoon rainfall. But here if we show, it went up to 110%. And when it comes to the withdrawal of this monsoon also, and this IMD has not forecasted or not expected such a delay in withdrawal. And the delay, actually this type of delay has happened only in the year 1961. And after that, this delay has not happened. That means IMD is predicting regarding the monsoon system, but some of the times these monsoon predictions are not becoming so accurate. So how actually this monsoon prediction will happen and what are the technicalities involved in that and how the various both regional, external, internal, extra regional factors are going to affect this monsoon and monsoon prediction, that we're going to learn in this video. So in this, first of all, we need to understand what is monsoon. What is monsoon? So monsoon is nothing but it is a periodic reversal of a wind is known as monsoon. It has taken from the Arabic word mausam. So here that monsoon in the sense the periodic reversal of winds. Periodic reversal of winds. So why there is a periodic reversal of wind in India? Suppose if we looking into our India, this is, so now actually this is land and this is sea. This is sea, and in the summer the land get heated more faster than the water. That means here it get more heat, and because of that the low pressure area created, because the whatever the air that is get heated become less denser, and that air will go up, and then there is a low pressure area that creates, and here comparatively high pressure is there, and because of that high pressure the wind flows from high pressure to low pressure. So here actually the waves, the wind flows from in this way. So this is what actually a one way of flowing of the waves into Indian Union or Indian territory. And here what happened is after it reached to certain level, again it will come back, again it will come back. So that means there is a seasonal reversal of winds. This is what we actually call it as monsoon. So what this monsoon will do for India? This monsoon will bring lot of rain to this entire India, and around 75 to 80% of the rain that we are getting in our country per annum is only through this southwest monsoon, because it enter India from the southwest direction of India. And in this southwest monsoon, the winds which actually carries the moisture from this ocean, that actually gives the rain to the entire Indian territory. So here the point is that what are the factors that involved in this monsoon deciding? So because unless we understand those factors, it is very difficult for us to understand and predict the monsoon. So when it comes to the monsoon, okay, so when it comes to the monsoon, here we have Himalayas. When it comes to the monsoon, actually this is sea, and I told in the month of summer, because of the heating level, the heating level gradient between land and sea, that means if the land is getting more heated, then the pressure is less, and comparatively the water, yes, it cannot heat that much faster as the land because of its own characteristics, like specificity and others. So here, whenever the low pressure creates, and here the winds from the high pressure area, it tries to enter into the Indian territory. And when they are entering into this Indian territory, it enters through the southwest direction. So that means here we need to understand the temperature gradient or the heating difference between ocean and the land mass is very important in deciding the monsoon. So that is the first thing. Next, second one is the intertropical convergence zone. So intertropical convergence zone is a part of trade winds, and here early actually it's intertropical convergence zone where the winds are converging from both the sides, from the northern hemisphere and southern hemisphere. Actually it will be generally around some 0 to 5 degrees. That means here the winds are converging like this. So but when the intertropical convergence zone in the summer, it shifts towards the northward. So it shifts, when it shifts towards the northwards, then all these winds that are entering, and here it will come to here, and it will try to go in this way. So that means this intertropical convergence zone is also one of the reason to spread monsoon in our India. Next, the westerly jets and Tibetan pressure is also one of the reason, because in the month of the summer the jets are the fast coming waves in the summer, they are coming in this higher direction, in this higher latitudes, and whereas in case of winter it will come in this. So whenever the western jets in the summer, whenever they are coming in this at a higher the latitude areas, here actually you have a Tibet, and because of this Tibet high in heating, low pressure is developed, and whatever it comes, it will be diverted to here, and whatever they diverted, it will come here. So that means here what actually we call it as westerly jets, but here we call it as tropical easterly jets. And these tropical easterly jets combined with the, here we have an African continent and here we have Mozambique, and it deals with this Mozambique pressure. So this Mozambique pressure and this whatever the tropical easterly jets combined, and it will push the winds into the Indian territory. That means here whatever the tropical jets is also a reason, and the temperature pressures at the Mozambique is also one of the reason for advancing the monsoon in our country. Next, when it comes to the withdrawal also, so once it reached here, so it cannot go beyond certain point, because there is a Himalayan mountains are there. So the snow cover of Himalayan mountain is also one of the reason for getting the reversal of wind or for experiencing a monsoon India. So that Himalayan is also a reason. Next, for the withdrawal of the wind, because of this westerly jets in the winter, when they are coming, actually these winds push the whatever the waves that are there and whatever the air that is there, that air will be pushed by these westerly jets in the month of winter, and because of that they try to withdraw from the Indian territory. So that means if we looking into our Indian monsoon, these are some of the factors which are related to our own region. And apart from that, the temperature of the Indian Ocean, the temperature of the Pacific Ocean, and even the pressure gradients of the Atlantic, and these are some of the things that are influencing the Indian monsoon. We'll getting into these topics little later. Okay. So this is something about the Indian monsoon system and the factors affecting the Indian monsoon system. And here when we are discussing about the monsoon, it is not just about the how much amount of rain it gives, but there are many factors that are involved in this monsoon. First one is onset of monsoon. First one is onset of monsoon. That means when we are experiencing the monsoon, whether it is delayed, whether it is early, whether it is in normal time. Next, once onset of monsoon is happened, next second one is about the distribution of monsoon. That means is it distributed properly or there is a delay in moving forward or there is any delay in moving forward. Next, the quantum of rain. The quantum of rain it is giving. So, does it really giving the sufficient amount of rain or it is giving only huge amount of rain in a smaller particular, in a smaller period of time, or that whatever the rain we are getting is equally throughout the country? That is also a question. And next, another one is withdrawal of the monsoon. Yes, whether this withdrawal is happening within a time or it is delaying, that is also a question. So, these are some of the things involved in Indian monsoon system. Okay. In our Indian system, so we need to understand this monsoon. So generally some organization called Indian Meteorological Department is concerned with the prediction of monsoon. That means when we are going to receive this monsoon and what type of monsoon we are getting. That means we are getting normal or above normal or average. So those things are decided by the Indian Meteorological Department, IMD. So it is works under the Ministry of Earth Sciences under Union Ministry. So this actually IMD has started in the year 1875. And at that point of time, this H.F. Blanford started this IMD. Because he is actually the first, earlier he was a reporter, but with this initiative, the then government of India started this IMD Institute. And this IMD, Indian Meteorological Department, is concerned with the prediction of monsoon in our India. Prediction of monsoon or India. So how actually this IMD goes? Actually IMD decides or forecasts the monsoon in terms of LPA, long period average. So what is this meaning of long period average? Long period average in the sense, so whatever the annual rain from the month of June to from the month of September for last 50 years, that means they took it from 1951 to 2000. So that means in this 50 years from the month of June to from the month of September, how much amount rain we got on average per year. So that is what we call it as long period average. And at present the long period average is 89 centimeters. So this is a long period average. So when IMD is calculating the or forecasting the monsoon, it calculates as a percentage of LPA, and based on that they will give some classification, like, because they will give, so this year there is a normal monsoon, there is an above normal monsoon, there is deficit. So that means, suppose normal in the sense 96 to 104% of LPA. Suppose if we are going to get or we are going to experience a rainfall of 96% to 104% of this long period average, we call it as normal monsoon. That is how actually the IMD gives. Next, deficit monsoon in the sense, if we experiencing less than 90% of this long period average in between this June to September, we call it as deficit monsoon. And if it is more than 110% of the long period average, then we say that we are above or we are excess monsoon we are getting. So based on these parameters, the IMD will provide what type of monsoon we are going to experience. And here when IMD is giving this information, they will go for the long range prediction, medium range prediction, short range prediction, excess range prediction and nowcast prediction. So what are these different terms? Suppose if we looking into nowcast. So nowcast in the sense, within few hours what is going to happen, how much amount of rain that we are going to experience in next few hours, max one day. So if that forecast deals about that forecast we call it as nowcast. Second one is short range in the sense within 72 hours within 72 hours, how much amount of rainfall or what are the conditions of the atmosphere, cloud cover, everything. If we are getting the information within 70, that means at the 72 hour period, the next 72 hour period, that we call it as short range. Next, medium range. Medium range in the sense from 4 to 10 days. 4 to 10 days, and in tropics we'll get up to 7 days. That means if we really able to predict what is going to happen in the next 10 days or next 7 days in the tropics, that forecast we call it as medium range forecast. Next, excess range. Excess range forecast is from medium range to 1 month. In the sense from 4 to 10 days to between 4 to 10 days to 30 days, what is going to happen, what is going to happen to rain and cloud cover and the atmospheric condition, that we call it as extended range. Next, long range. So, long range in the sense from 30 days or a month to the end of season. The end of season, that means from 30 days to end of season. This is long range prediction. Long range prediction in the sense from 1 month to the end of the season. That means on overall in the entire season, how much amount of rain that we are going to experience is given by the long range prediction. And when it comes to the long range prediction, the IMD gives two predictions. First one is in the mid of the April. Next one is at the end of the June. So that first one in the mid of the April with the available conditions, it going to predict. But something may happen in between. So once the monsoon enter into India and by the end of the June again it will recalculate and it will look into the different parameters and finally it will decide, that is a June month end prediction. So in that way we will get two types of predictions for the long range. So one is in the midst of April and another one is at the end of the June. So these are some of the predictions found by the Indian Meteorological Department, and here they are going to give this normal excess deficit rainfall figures based on the percentage of long period average, long period average. So when this IMD is calculating or IMD is forecasting our Indian monsoon, it considers various factors, but we need to understand how these models evolved over a period of time and what was the earlier stage of this prediction levels and when we actually predicted first time for the Indian monsoon. So when in the year 1975 this IMD was established, at that point of time the head or the key person in that is H.F. Blanford, and immediately in the 1877 there was a famine in India because of monsoon failure that has necessitated for the then government to predict the Indian monsoon, and accordingly they have given the task to the IMD, and IMD forecasted its first monsoon prediction in the year of 1886, in the year of 1886, 4th June. So 4th June 1886, they have given first prediction, and when they have given the first prediction by this Blanford, and he tried to relate the snow cover of Himalayas, snow cover of Himalayas, and he tried to draw an inverse relation between the annual Indian monsoon or Indian summer monsoon rain with the Himalayan snow cover with an inverse relation. That means he thought that if the Himalayan snow cover is more, then Indian there is some sort of inverse relation. It's not exactly normal our geometrical relation, but he tried to draw some sort of inverse relation based on that Himalayan snow cover. He tried to predict the level of monsoon. But after that 1886 prediction model, and during the next course of years, the entire the prediction models are changed from time to time. And mainly in this prediction model, we need to understand this Gilbert Walker model. So, in Gilbert Walker model, so in the early 20th century, in the sense in the 1908, 1918, 1923, so during these years he tried to evolve a different model, and for his model he tried to calculate the temperatures, pressures, atmospheric various conditions, the rainfall throughout the world, and he tried to analyze the how actually these parameters are influencing the Indian monsoon. Indian monsoon. So he tried to look for various parameters. At one point of time, he tried to correlate around 28 type of parameters. That means here actually he developed a model called, we call it as a statistic model. And here in this statistic model, what actually he do is, he try to calculate, he try to identify some of the parameters, and in these parameters, how actually these parameters are varying, or how these parameters are correlating with each other and correlating with the monsoon level in India, and he try to devolve a particular relation, and he expects that the similar type of relation is going to happen in future also. That means he extrapolated the past results or the past 100 years of results, and he emphasized on that correlation coefficient. So how actually these parameters are related to one another, and these parameters are how they related to monsoon, and he tried to extrapolate the same thing that this might going to happen in future also. That is what we call it as statistic model. And he introduced that statistic model, and India followed more than 100 years the same statistic model, but with different some sort of minor modifications. Again, in Gilbert Walker model, he tried to identify some of the ocean oscillations, that means the ocean or the sea surface temperatures, how they are affecting globally. He tried to identify and he tried to relate it with the Indian monsoon. And for that, he took this North Atlantic ocean temperatures, Northern Pacific Ocean temperatures, and Southern Ocean temperatures. But he thought that the Northern Atlantic and Northern Pacific are very regional. But whatever is happening in the southern part, it is having its own global influence. And with that southern oscillations, he considered as one of the parameter for deciding the Indian monsoon. And later during the course of the time in the 1980s, and whatever today we are talking about El Nino, this El Nino is directly linked with the southern oscillation concept of the Gilbert Walker model. And when this Gilbert Walker has modified his model in the year 1923, after that, prior to that 1924, we used to predict for the entire India. But after 1924, he tried to give a different predictions for northwestern part of India, northeastern part of India, and peninsular part of India. So in the 1924, he started giving different predictions for these three different regions. But later he realized that by the time of 1935, the annual variation in the northeastern part, the annual variation in the rainfall in the northeastern part is very less. So we no need to consider this northeastern. So he abandoned this northeastern, but northwestern and peninsular India, we started predicting this. And this has continued till 1988. But when it comes to the year in the 1988, and we identified that whatever the factors that Gilbert Walker has taken, some are becoming irrelevant. And when we consider the parameters in the Gilbert Walker model or the subsequent models, it includes regional factors, it includes extra regional factors, it includes southern oscillations. That means there are many factors are there. We cannot confine only just to the India and India's neighbors. So at that point of time, yes, this model has changed because some of the parameters has lost its relevance. And in the year 1988, we try to modify this model, and we devise a new model called 16 parameter model. And each parameter we call it as predictant. So that means it is a predictor point. So for the prediction of the monsoon, we are using some 16 points. And whatever we are doing this 16 point, we started from 1988 to till 2000. Because 1988 to 2000, whatever the IMD has predicted, mostly it followed. But in the year 1997-1999, we are unable to predict whatever the crisis or the deficit of monsoon with the same formula. And then actually the problem came. And by the time of year 2000, in the year 1995, the Krishna Kumar, he is a well-known, renowned scientist, and he try to link the temperatures of the eastern coast of India and the temperatures of the western coast of India and central India need to be included in the 16 point formula that actually he thought. And Govarikar report of 1989 has also included that some of the 7 points which are included by this 1988 model is also not relevant. Some 7 points are not relevant. So that means it has undergone some modifications, but by the time of 1997, when this Krishna Kumar has prepared its own model, and he said that whatever we are preparing a model, in that we need to identify the exact share of the parameters. And according to his own research, more than half of the Indian monsoon is influenced by the El Nino Southern Oscillations, ENSO, El Nino Southern Oscillation. So we need to consider that El Nino Southern Oscillation. Earlier we are considering that, but the problem is that we need to give more weightage to this El Nino Southern Oscillation. That is what his recommendation in his own thing. But anyhow, the 1988 model, it has not given enough results because it has failed. Mostly it has given success in most of the time, but whenever we are experiencing a huge deficit of monsoon, then actually it has not predicted. So we need to change some four parameters of this 16 point, and we modified the same the formula. And here we need to understand that still we are following a statistical model. That means we are changing the parameters, but our model is same thing. That means we identify some of the parameters, we are comparing these parameters for the last 100 years, and how actually the monsoon affecting with these parameters, and we wanted to extrapolate the same thing to the future generation or the future predictions. So that is what actually we have done. And by the time of 2000, when we have modified all these parameters, or four parameters, and finally whatever we devised, and at that point of time the parameters we consider are the El Nino. So here El Nino in the sense, El Nino means the temperature difference between the central and southern Pacific Ocean of both east and west coast. That means on the Peru coast of the Pacific, on the Peru coast and as well as the Australian coast, what is the difference between? Here actually we generally strictly take that Tahiti and Darwin temperature difference. These two are the places in the Pacific Ocean that temperature difference will consider. And suppose here in the case of El Nino, if this Peru and Chile part is warm more, that means if it is warming, then actually the pressure is low, and here the pressure is high. The winds move from high pressure to lower pressure, and here we will get more amount of rain. Suppose if this part is heating more and this part is heating less, then here the high pressure, then here the low pressure, the winds move from high pressure to low pressure, so we are getting more amount of rain this side. And this is what we call it as a normal thing. But if it is heated more and more, and if it is this side is heated more and more and this side heated less, we call that condition as La Nino. But if this Peru coast is heating more and more, we consider this concept called El Nino. That means there is a temperature difference between the two parts of this Pacific Ocean, in the southern and the central Pacific part. So this has its own effect. Suppose if El Nino is stronger, that means the Peru coast is gaining more and more heat, then definitely that is affecting an Indian monsoon, and we are not going to have a good amount of monsoon. So in that way, the El Nino. And when it consider the El Nino, we need to look into the El Nino of previous year, and what is the condition of El Nino present year. What is the El Nino condition of previous year, and what are the conditions of El Nino of present year, that we need to consider into this. Next, South Indian Ocean sea surface temperature. The temperature of the Indian Ocean is also influencing the Indian monsoon. So we try to identify this, the southern Indian Ocean sea surface temperature. Next, east coast of India temperature, as what Krishna Kumar suggested, east coast of India temperature. Next, Arabian sea surface temperature, west coast. Arabian sea surface temperature. Next, central Indian temperature. And apart from that, some international factors called the Eurasian snow cover. Eurasian snow cover. And apart from Eurasian snow cover, the Himalayan snow cover. Next, Argentinian pressure. So what is the pressure at the Argentina? That Argentinian pressure. And next, the Southern Oscillation Index. Southern Oscillation Index. So the Southern Oscillation Index means what is happening in the Southern Ocean part. So these are some of the things, that we consider in the 16-point model. So in the by considering the relation between each and everything and the relation in toto with the monsoon for the last 100 years, and we wanted to do and we wanted to apply it to the further forecasting. So this is actually about the 16 point model or the 16 parameter model or the 16 predictor model. So this model has continued whatever the changed model in the year 2000, and we continued the same model till 2015. But even the same model, which has not given enough results in the year 2002, 2004, 2006 and 2007. That means there were serious drops at the 2004 and 2002, and even we are experiencing whatever we expected, and the marginal error is more than plus or minus 4% in these years. That means if you really looking into the model from 1988 to 2015, it is in the year 1997, 1999, 2002, 2004, 2006, 7. So these are some of the years where actually we are deviated from completely our predictions. That means even the statistic model we have adjusted with some points, but still our IMD has not able to predict some of the shocks or some of the deficits and some of the problems. So what is the problem in this entire thing that we need to understand? So in this statistical model, we used power regression techniques and multiple regression model, dynamic stochastic model, principal component regression model. So these are some of the models, and we came to know that whatever the 16 parameters we consider, they are having some non-linear relationship. But the problem is with our model. Because even we are changing some of the parameters, these parameters are just changed, but the model, that means the relation between those things, how you are devising, is actually we are not changing. That might be a problem. So we need to shift from the statistic model to the dynamic model. In the year 2007, we identified that, but from the 2015 onwards, We started testing this dynamic model. So what is the meaning of this dynamic model? Dynamic model in the sense, whatever the parameters we are considering, they don't maintain same type of relation all the time. You cannot simply extrapolate the earlier relations for the future, and there might be some sort of dynamism in between the relations between the parameters of this prediction model. So we need to devise a new model. That's what we call it as a dynamic model. And with this dynamic model, we can identify the amount of monsoon both spatially and temporally. That means at a particular point of time, in a particular place, how much amount of rain we are going to experience, and what would be the environmental condition, what would be the climate and weather conditions at that particular point. That actually we can identify with these dynamic models. So actually these dynamic models we are implementing in a limited way, but still we need to get more and more expertise in that. So here in this dynamic model, we need to looking into much more parameters into consideration, because if you are really choosing a particular location, the parameters of that particular location is also important. Because in the statistical model, generally we are calculating that long range prediction in the overall India, and that long range prediction by statistical model may not help the farmers completely, because we need a dynamic model. We need to predict the monsoon both spatially and temporally, then only the farmers and the governments and whatever the people will really make plan accordingly. make plan accordingly. So that is why we are bringing some sort of dynamic models into existence. And for this dynamic model, we need to bring some mathematical equation, three-dimensional analysis, we need supercomputers, and we have started that experiment in the year 2015, and we are simulating so many equations with so many parameters, and with that way we try to identify these things. But here the question is that even after the dynamic models are also introduced, why we are not forecasting some of the events. And for that, some of the scientists are giving a reason that, see, we are predicting under some conditions, but immediately something happened, then it is very difficult for us to change the model accordingly. So this is what actually the scientific community is saying. Suppose we are predicting at a particular point in the month of April and in the month of the June. But if something happened after the June, then definitely it has its own effect. Suppose if you take recently, when the monsoon entered into the state of Kerala, suddenly there was a cyclone called Vayu in the Arabian Sea. And because of that cyclone, there was no much progress in the advancement of the monsoon. And suppose if you really looking into this year prediction, earlier we thought that there was an El Nino, but later at the month of April and after that, we realized that this time El Nino is getting weak. So we might experience more and more amount of rain. So here the problem is that the parameters are changing from time to time, and if the parameters are changed, then it is difficult to predict the models. That is what they are saying. But some other people are saying that why can't we understand such changing level of parameters? Suppose let us take Indian Ocean Dipole is now becoming a more important player in our Indian monsoon. So generally it affects more and more on both African climate and African weather conditions and Indonesia. It is something between Africa and Indonesia. This is an Indian Ocean. Suppose if this is getting warm and this is getting cold, we call it as positive Indian Ocean Dipole. And if it is cold and if it is warm, then we call it as negative Indian Ocean Dipole. And suppose if it is positive Indian Ocean Dipole, it is positive for India. If it is negative Indian Ocean Dipole, it is negative to India. But here we need to understand when we are correlating with the El Nino. El Nino is nothing but this is Peru coast, this is Australia coast, this is Indonesia coast, this is Africa coast. Suppose here it is warmer, it is getting cooler, that means it is cooler, it is warmer. So here it is a positive, but here it is, this actually this condition is El Nino. And here actually we are positive IOD. Here El Nino is something negative to India, but positive IOD is positive to India. So here whenever there is an El Nino, the positive IOD tried to help the Indian monsoon. And whenever you are getting a La Nino, here we will getting a negative dipole, and this negative dipole tried to reduce the monsoon. So that means here we are calculating this IOD. But here the point is that can you really predict the temperature of the Indian Ocean, both west and east? If suddenly, okay, once before monsoon enters, if you experiencing a positive dipole, it is good for India. Suddenly, okay, it is not maintaining a positive IOD, but once the monsoon enter India, then we experience a positive IOD. What will that positive IOD after entering the monsoon affect the Indian climate? We need to understand. Suppose there is a positive IOD, and once the monsoon enter, suddenly if it turns to negative IOD, how it is going to affect? The thing is that scientists are saying that these are the sudden events, but some people are saying that there is a reason to predict this also. There is a reason to predict these type of parameters also. If we really able to predict such type of changes in different parameter level, then we can identify or then we can forecast our monsoon perfectly. And here we need to understand that whatever the interference between the oceanic and the atmosphere, the interference of the oceanic conditions and atmospheric conditions, we need to understand perfectly how the ocean temperatures, ocean pressures, or ocean the humidity, moisture levels are really influencing the atmospheric condition on the land or whatever that interaction point. So that is what actually we need to do to forecast this model more and more, because the point is that the whatever the parameters, and here in dynamic model the parameters are changing, the parameters are changing from time to time, the parameters are changing from place to place. So here anyway the model is dynamic, but we need to understand that the change in parameter level also, then we can predict our Indian monsoon perfectly. And here actually whatever there is a limitation of statistical model. Statistical model has its own limitation and it cannot give a prediction 100%. But with the dynamic model, if we really understanding the dynamics of the different parameters, definitely we can expect, definitely we can forecast the exact monsoon. And here some people are again questioning that what is an effect of climate change on this? What is an effect of climate change on this changing monsoon level? And here the point is that yes, climate change is actually affecting on the surface temperatures of the land and the surface temperatures of the ocean, and it is also influencing the surface temperatures of the snow cover of both Himalayan, Eurasian, Arctic, everything. So when such temperatures are raising, definitely it has its own influence of the moisture pressure levels, moisture levels and pressure levels. So here the point is that, how this climate change is going to affect the Indian monsoon. Does it really going to affect the overall monsoon of India, or it cannot change the overall monsoon rainfall, but it can change the distribution of that monsoon in India? That is the main question we need to understand. Suppose if you take this year, there was a torrential rain like cloudburst in Bombay city and even in Bihar also. Why actually we are experiencing such a cloudburst, and why we are getting so much of amount of rain in a particular short amount of period? And some people are attributing this to the climate change, because the temperatures are increases, there is a more low pressure area and there is more cloud formation, and that is why it is giving more amount of rain to a particular places. But on overall, the India is gaining more and more amount of rainfall because of this climate change. That is a question mark. And some people saying that whatever the climate change, it can distribute internally with variation, but it cannot certainly change the entire rainfall in the India. That also we need to understand, because the parameters are changing, you need to adjust the parameters and accordingly you need to change your model, and then only we can predict the monsoon perfectly. So we need to understand the influence of the climate change also. And definitely this climate change is going to have its effect, but to what extent it is going to have is the question mark. But whatever the flash floods we are experiencing, it is because of the temperature difference and the increasing temperature levels. So this is something about the effect of climate change on Indian monsoon. And here the point is that why actually we need to predict the monsoon is a bigger question that we need to understand. Because in our India, almost the 45 to 50% of the population is directly and indirectly depending on agriculture sector. And in our agriculture sector, the most of the 60% of the land is completely depending on rain. In spite of your having your irrigation and other facilities, but 60% of the land is depending on the monsoon. Suppose if you don't get a monsoon perfectly, this agriculture sector is going to affect. If this agriculture sector is affected, it has its own consequences of the negative consequences on the remaining sector, because almost 50% of the people losing their purchasing power for a particular season. Definitely it reduces the demand in the economy, and in that way the entire economy get affected because of this monsoon. That is the reason why the governments, the farmers, the private organizations, some manufacturing companies, they look for this April prediction, because that will give some sort of boost, because government has to prepare a plan, it has to make a credit plan, it has to make a seeds supply plan, it has to make fertilizer subsidy and other things, and farmers are waiting for the monsoon. So that is the reason why this monsoon forecast is imparted. Suppose if monsoon is not good, then if you don't have enough food production, we need to import. So our import plans also has to be devised immediately. immediately. So that is the thing. Suppose if there is no domestic demand and whatever the manufacturing things that are available in the country, immediately you need to export. Immediately you need to export. That means all our economic policies are depending on this monsoon. Depending on this monsoon. And again, the another question that is raising is why actually monsoon has took this much time to return back. Why there was a delay in returning the monsoon this year? Because after 1961 only the monsoon has stayed this much amount of time. And because the monsoon has stayed this much of time in India, that is the reason why it is giving more and more amount of rainfall in the southwest monsoon season. And here whatever we are predicting for the monsoon, we are only predicting for the southwest monsoon, but unfortunately that returning wind, northeastern monsoon, we are unable to find because we don't have a specific parameters to analyze those things, and our focus is completely on the southwest monsoon, but we are not focusing on northeast monsoon. Northeast monsoon is also important because whatever the delay in retrieving the monsoon will definitely affect the agricultural seasons. Seasons, because we are at the harvest time, and even we reach to the harvest time, if the monsoon still continued in India, if it continuously provide the rain, then it is difficult to harvest the food crop. So here we need to identify, we need to forecast the northeast monsoon also, and this northeast monsoon is going to provide around 20-25% of the rainfall, mostly in Tamil Nadu and as well as the southern part of Andhra Pradesh. So here the prediction of northeast monsoon is also important along with the southwest monsoon of India. So this is something about the monsoon prediction of India. And apart from this IMD, which is a governmental institute, the SkyMet is something, a private organization. They are also provide a parallel the long range prediction of the Indian monsoon rainfall. So that is the reason why this monsoon is important, and this is a private organization. IMD is completely government of India's one, and here the IMD has its own installation. It collects the data from different parts of the ocean, different parts of the world, and they try to compare the pressure differences everywhere, and they're looking into the Atlantic Ocean, the temperatures and pressures. They're looking into Eurasian, whatever the snow cover, Indian central region, the temperatures and pressures, Himalayan snow cover, and Indian Ocean Dipole, El Nino and La Nino. So by considering various things, now they are changing towards the models. Earlier our problem is we are changing the parameters, but our models are completely statistical. But anyway, now we enter into a dynamic models called coupled forecast system model. We call CFS model. That CFS model is devising, but the point is that we need to predict the changing parameter level. If we really reach to such a capacity, and then it is very easy for us to understand. And meanwhile, we need to understand this climate change and also interaction between the ocean and atmosphere and the formation of clouds in India, which factors are really influencing that. If we understand these parts completely, then we can forecast our Indian monsoon with a higher precision, and that is also important for both India economically and socially. So let us hope that whatever the governmental programs that will move in forward, and if we support with much more financial resources and also technological support, this Indian Institute of Meteorology at Pune, definitely they are going to do this, and let us hope that the government will provide such support and our scientific community will really looking into these issues. And with this note, I am concluding. Thank you.